You're listening to the Hour of the Time. I'm William Cooper. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. For those of you on the internet, go to harvest-trust.org and you'll see that apparently there were some of the enemy at our new server company. They have completely deleted 2 years of work, countless thousands of hours sitting in front of computers, inputting data and creating one of the largest websites on the internet, is now gone, disappeared, destroyed. Not to mention the countless thousands and thousands of dollars that we put into it. So 2 years, thousands of hours of work and thousands of dollars down the tube with the stroke of a key on a computer board. Go to our old website, harvest-trust.org, and read the story for yourself. That's all I can tell you. Tonight you're going to hear the soundtrack from Day 51, The True Story of Waco. So pay attention, folks. And once again, we might learn something. Uh-oh, got a problem with the soundtrack, and I'm going to try to fix that. Sorry, folks. Don't know what's wrong, but I'll find out and be right back. Okay, folks, we got our fix. Just let me back it up to the beginning again, and then we'll go. And that'll only take a few seconds, I think. At least I hope. Okay, here we go.
There's women, children, and men involved in our situation here at Mount Carmel. But I am really concerned about the lives of my brethren here, and also really concerned even greater about the lives of all those in this world.
remains today of the Branch Davidian Church home near Waco, Texas, is a pile of rubble and a lot of unanswered questions.
Did not have to end that way. But man is so impatient and then thinks he's so intelligent. He tries to outdo God. But what the people did not understand is that they were fighting God. And if you read Psalms 2, you'll find out that God is laughing at the people that think they have won the war. It's His war, and He'll finish it.
Anybody who has met any of us Davidians, Branch Davidians, has said, when we meet you, we see how intelligent, how honest, how just what you're like. And that's not the picture that's been painted in the media of what we are at all. They said cults, you know, and you've seen a picture of a building, and pictures have been painted in your minds about who we were and what we were and what we believed and what we stood for. People said we were brainwashed, we were mind controlled. Those things were not true at all. We were all there studying the Bible because we could see that David had something to teach that nobody else did.
The Branch Davidian doctrine is often misunderstood, and it was over a difference of interpretation of the book of Revelations that led its founder, Peter Howduff, to leave the Seventh-day Adventist Church.
We believe that the Bible in its entirety, from the book of Genesis all the way through the book of Revelation, including some books that were not included in the King James Bible, are all prophetic, and they all point to the times that we're coming to today.
He moved his followers from Los Angeles to Waco, Texas in 1935, purchased property near Lake Waco, and established the Mount Carmel Center. This original property was later sold, and the church moved to a location about 12 miles east of Waco. They believed the return of Christ is imminent. In 1959, about 900 church members gathered here at the new Mount Carmel to await the second coming. In this rare interview, Branch Davidian spokesman Dudley Goff explained the biblical basis for their religious beliefs.
The purpose in his gathering all nations there to battle is that he might prepare the land so that he can set up his kingdom, so that his people might return there and set up his kingdom in compliance or in fulfillment of the prophecy of Daniel 2:44, where the Lord says he's going to set up his kingdom down in the last day. That particular prophecy is brought out on this small chart.
Unlike mainstream Protestant theology, the Branch Davidians do not believe there will be a rapture of the church. They believe Christians will endure the tribulation, suffer persecution for their faith.
The image to pieces, and Daniel said that this stone is God's kingdom that is set up in the days of these kings that are represented by the toes.
We have come down to the toes of time. The feet of the image, which would be divided. Daniel saw our day. He saw exactly what would happen, and he was told in Daniel 12. Daniel and Revelation are two books that go hand in hand.
After the death of Victor Howduff in 1955, church leadership went to Benjamin and Lois Roden, but over the years, their numbers slowly dwindled away. And Vernon Howell, who later changed his name to David Koresh, appeared on the scene in the 1980s. Many thought it was a sign.
He did his best. That's why everything he tried, he did his best. He made an effort in letting us know he cared about us. And he was from the beginning, from Palestine up until the time when we saw the big house there. He was always improving our life, always trying to help us.
Every living soul that accepts Christianity, I challenge them to show me the seven seals of Revelation 4 and 5. And if they can't do it, then I show them. And if they're honest, they'll see it.
Like many survivalist groups today, the Branch Davidians began to prepare for the coming persecution. They purchased weapons for self-defense and stored food supplies to sustain them.
A lot of people vilified the Branch Davidians because they had a lot of food, they had a lot of ammo, they were sort of separatists, survivalists, waiting for Armageddon. And, you know, while you might not want that sort of person living next door to you, there's really nothing wrong with it. There's nothing illegal about it. There's nothing that...
When a disgruntled church member, Monroe, was expelled for improper conduct, He went to the authorities with fabricated stories of child molesting and weapons violations.
Him having sex with underage girls was and molesting children and so forth was something that was cooked up by members who were booted out for immoral behavior and the FBI and the ATF. It was a good excuse to do what they did out at Mount Carmel.
The Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms was originally established to collect taxes for the U.S. Treasury Department. Today, their mission is the disarming of the American civilian population. Therefore, the Branch Davidian Church near Waco became a target for extermination. Davidian church members compare it to an attack on a Viet Cong village, made even more curious by the newspaper articles that had just been released. In a display of flagrant disregard, the Waco Tribune Herald began running a series of reports out the Branch Davidians on the same day of the ATF assault. Equally curious is the fact that it was the undercover agent, Robert Rodriguez, who brought copies of the newspaper to Mount Carmel that very morning.
Papers were brought in the morning by Robert. And I was down, I came down there when he was showing them to the different people that were down there. And I read a little bit about it, but then one of the men went out and got some of the papers and brought them back. And a little later I came back down and picked a paper up to bring it up to my room to read it completely. And I noticed they... two cattle cars coming in and pull up in front, and I ran upstairs to read the paper. I thought the men were going to do something with that.
Catherine went upstairs to her room, and the attack on Mount Carmel began.
After I got upstairs, I heard three helicopters. The reason I know there were three because I looked out the window to see where they were, what they were doing, and they were firing on us.
With a search warrant of questionable legality, agents of the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms launched a raid on the Branch Davidian Church home. It was Sunday morning, February 28, 1993, and Catherine Matheson's absolutely positive that government agents fired the first shots.
I saw and I heard it. And I was in the back of the building. That's where my room was. And they were firing toward David's room. And they turned, and when they turned, I fell to the floor because I could see that those bullets could have hit me if I was standing. So they went to the front of the building, and it seemed like when they got in the front, by the time they got to the front, they were firing again, and so all the others were firing.
When questioned further about her observations that day, Catherine was adamant. She was certain of what she saw and heard.
Definitely. They were the only ones I heard and saw at the time that they were coming in the helicopter. There's no one else firing.
Questioned separately, Annetta Richards' testimony is virtually identical to that of Catherine Madison's.
I was actually getting ready for worship, and I heard a noise like an helicopter, and then I heard bullets start firing, you know, bullets start coming in from every direction, and the helicopters were flying over the building. It was, the sound of it was so low that at what time I thought they had landed on the roof. It was really so low. And bullets were coming from all directions, and I heard a voice saying, get down. So those of us who were there in the hallway went down on our, on the floor, on our tummy, on our hands and feet. And I looked around and I saw some children. So I took them close to me, and there was a baby. A little 10-year-old girl was holding her. And I took the baby from her and lay over him, put my body over the baby so that if the bullet came through, it would hit me instead of the baby.
There is corroboration for their testimony of gunfire from the helicopters. It comes from one of the Branch Davidian children who left Mount Carmel that evening and was later told by psychologist Dr. Bruce Perry.
And as I asked her, is there anything else? She took her crayon and went. And I asked what that was and said that was bullets.
No sooner had the dust settled than the ATF began to lie and cover up about their actions during the raid. They acted as though the Branch Davidians had come looking for them.
The main problem we had, I don't believe, is that we were outmaneuvered or outplanned. The problem we had is that we were outgunned.
Fed up with the obvious lies, a young independent investigator named Ron Cole decided it was time to get involved. He packed his bags and headed for Waco. After talking with eyewitnesses and conducting his own research, Ron Cole arrived at the obvious conclusion. Using a scale model of Mount Carmel, he relates the sequence of events that fateful Sunday morning.
Those people that I talked to that were in a position to see the helicopters indicate the helicopters fired first, whereas those that were in front of the center couldn't see the helicopters, could hear them, but saw the agents exiting the cattle trailers. They say the first shots came from these ATF agents at the front. That's why I'm saying it seems to me the shots were fired from agents at the front and from the helicopters within seconds of each other, which means there would not have been enough time for some emergency code word to have been used or for someone else inside to fire the first shot that would have initiated simultaneous fire from the ground and from the air within seconds of each other. That indicates to me that this was planned in advance. It was a frontal assault from the ground and air support coming in from the back, simultaneous pre-planned attack.
We practiced for it. They drilled over and over again. And we had our plan down, we had a diversion down.
When the ATF agents arrived at Mount Carmel, they should have noticed the Branch Davidian men were not where they were expected to be. Ron Cole explains.
When the two ATF cattle trailers pulled into the driveway from W.E. Ranch Road out front of the property, the team that was in the first cattle trailer, they were supposed to exit the trailer here and go to the under-construction tornado shelters where they thought most of the men would be that morning trying to finish up the shelters themselves. The second trailer, they were supposed to disembark and crash through the front door. Part of the team, the other part of the team, was to come around the side up these ladders and into what they thought was the gun room. And another small part of that second cattle trailer team, they were supposed to go and suppress the dogs either with a fire extinguisher or, if need be, with gunshots. In fact, so far the testimony that's come out of the trial is that the opening shots may in fact have been fired by ATF agents at the cattle trailers.
When David Koresh saw the ATF agents piling out of the cattle trailers, he opened the front door and made an attempt to stop the attack.
I opened the front door as they were running up. Of course, you know, their tactical expertise. They've got their guns aimed and everything. They started hollering, you know. All of them hollering know what they were saying. And I was already hollering. I was saying, you know, go away. You know, I was hollering, go away. There's women and children here. Let's talk. They started firing at me. And so what happened was is that I stepped back in the door and the bullets started coming through the door. And so what happened was some of the human and stuff started firing on them.
Koresh's version of attack was later confirmed by Brad Branch in a phone call from the McLennan County Jail.
When they jumped out, David opened the door and put his hand out and says, now hold on, we have women and children in here. And bullets started hitting the door and all through the foyer. And that's when we slammed the door.
Six Branch Davidians were killed during the attack. Among them was Australian-born Peter Gent, who was working inside the old water tower and simply looked out to see what was going on.
Peter Gent was shot here on top of the water tower.
while he was working, cleaning out the inside of the water tower, he came to the top level that he had built. He had built several levels so that he could clean out the inside of it from top to bottom, and when he poked up over the top level there, he was shot.
David Koresh's father-in-law, Perry Jones, was standing behind him when he opened the front door. Jones took several bullets meant for Koresh and died about an hour later.
The child's testimony to Dr. Perry concerning the holes, the dots that she drew in the roof, corroborate with what a lot of other people that were in there said, including Catherine Madison and Dick DeGaron. Dick DeGaron was interviewed by Diane Sawyer on ABC Primetime, and he stated in the interview that he clearly saw the ceiling as it appeared looked quote-unquote like Swiss cheese because it had holes all in it from bullets fired through the roof. The only way, obviously, these bullet holes could be in the ceiling through the roof is from helicopter fire. And I've talked to David Jones' little six-year-old daughter, and I asked her, what did you do on February 28th? What happened? And she said that bullets were coming through the roof, and she ran and hid under her bed, and her brother, who was 3 years older than her, ran down the hall and to the stairwell. As a matter of fact, Winston Blake, who was one of the people killed inside Mount Carmel on the first day, he was found with a bullet hole through the top of his head, and he was still holding a piece of French toast.
I was stupefied when I heard bullets coming, because it was like, you know, it was so frightening. You hear the bullets coming in, you don't know why, where, how. There was nothing you could do, you know. It was frightening. Nobody had any time to prepare for anything. It was just so sudden.
The last shooting that day occurred around 7 p.m. and was reported by the news media in this manner.
A couple of hours ago, about 7 o'clock tonight, there was more gunfire. Three members of the cult came out of the compound firing at ATF agents. One of the members was killed, another was taken into custody, and a third was
That news report was a complete lie. Once again, Ron Cole sets the record straight.
Mike Schroeder, Bob Kendrick, and Norman Allison were not inside Mount Carmel Center on the morning of February 28th when this raid took place. All three of them were at the mag bag several miles away when they heard about it on the radio. They made the decision, after hearing about the raid, to try to get back home. Mike Schroeder had his wife, his baby boy inside. Nobody knew who was alive or dead or what had happened exactly. Mike Schroeder attempted a mad dash from off the property, trying to get over this fence and to the paint shop on Mount Carmel. Unfortunately, he was seen by Special Agent Daryl Dyer, who had his outpost set up since before the raid in the hay barn off the property. Mike ran towards this fence, and although he was unarmed, well, he was armed with nothing but a stun gun, Daryl Dyer emptied his 30-round submachine gun magazine into Mike, striking him 7 times in the back.
Agent Dyer fired one burst at him, but somehow Mike kept on struggling. Got about 10 feet from the property line here, and where you see these sections cut off of this tree, that's where his body rest for several days, where they saw fit to remove him.
The official reason for the raid on Mount Carmel was to search for illegal weapons and arrest David Koresh. However, as it turns out, most of the guns were not even there.
We did have somewhat of a collection, but the weapons were never intended to...
Paul Vada, who worked gun shows all over Texas and who lived up at Mount Carmel, who in fact was responsible for most of the gun purchases through the mag bag that he rented out. On February 28th, that morning, while the raid took place, he was at a gun show in Austin with his son, along with most of the weapons that the ATF come there to seize.
There was a business that David was conducting with selling firearms.
Paul Fada and David Koresh sold guns and other merchandise at gun shows, as do many gun dealers. This was a perfectly legitimate enterprise and gave David Koresh a chance to talk to people about his religious beliefs.
I met a guy one time real briefly at a gun show a couple of years ago. I was passing out flyers and he wanted to talk guns and the Bible, so I...
The ATF wasn't looking for Bibles when they raided Mount Carmel, but they should have known that most of the guns were in Austin with Paul Fada.
The ATF had an undercover house across the street, 100 yards away from the front door of McConnell Center. They had that place under surveillance 24 hours a day, every day, for weeks prior to the February 28th raid. And they had to be aware of the fact that Paul was working these gun shows. And it seems to me, unless they're completely ignorant of reality, they ought to have been able to see from 100 yards away Paul leaving to go to this gun show. And after weeks of surveillance and several of these shows, should have figured out that the vast majority of those weapons would not have even been there.
Guns may not have been the only thing the ATF was looking for.
Jeff Little was an analyst, a computer analyst for Yamaha of America's headquarters in Buena Park, California. And
Branch Davidians Jeff Little and Wayne Martin had been conducting their own investigation of the ATF using computers located inside Mount Carmel.
I think that the possibilities for Jeff Little and Wayne Martin to have been able to tap into information concerning the ATF or any other part of the federal government would be very high. I saw some information. They were collecting information on all of the ATF activities over the last several years.
In April of 1991, after Operation Desert Storm, Marine Corps fast sea lift vessels returned to Port Arthur, Texas. A ship's officer, who refused an interview and does not wish to be identified, says that his ship's cargo hold was full of helicopters. Concealed inside the helicopters were thousands of weapons confiscated from captured Iraqi soldiers. These helicopters, with the weapons inside, were then loaded onto flatbed rail cars and shipped to Fort Sill, Oklahoma. It is believed that these firearms are intended for distribution to American street gangs, which are currently being converted by police agencies into law enforcement units. The weapons, of course, would not be traceable. These gangs, working with the ATF, will be used to enter civilian homes to confiscate weapons. Is it possible that Jeff Little and Wayne Martin accessed classified government computer files through a back door and had obtained this information?
Yeah, I think that it's very possible that there could have been some kind of information that they had on the computer inside the building there that was information the ATF did not want to get out. And I think they seem to be awfully anxious to get into that one window that everyone saw them going into. And there's a possibility that it might have been something besides guns they were after.
Evening settled in over the dark hills of central Texas, and the long siege began. 51 days of terror, 51 days of darkness and hope and frustration, and all of America lived through it. Never before in the history of law enforcement had so many personnel exerted so much effort for so little reason. The search warrant primarily listed conversion kits, which may have altered an AR-15 assault rifle, which might have been installed by the Branch Davidians, which could have created an illegal machine gun. To make such a weapon legal, a $200 tax must be paid. Therefore, the ATF and FBI ultimately spent $7 million in order to collect $200. Did the police believe David Koresh was a vicious criminal guilty of kidnapping, rape, murder, and all sorts of heinous crimes? No, they did not. McLennan County Sheriff Jack Harwell knew David on a first-name basis, and in 1987, following a shootout with George Roden, had arrested David and searched the property without incident. Americans everywhere sat in the comfort of their homes and watched the drama unfold. They witnessed the trampling of the Constitution and the Bill of Rights. Those who seek to control guns will also try to control people. Those who control the masses care not for the lives of innocent men, women, and children. The standoff at Mount Carmel gradually evolved into a surreal cosmic struggle between good and evil, freedom and slavery, free will and tyranny. Next day, Monday, March 1, dawned clear and bright, however. A radio talk show host in Dallas, Ron Engelman, refused to toe the official government line and took up the cause of the Branch Davidians.
I'll see you guys out there, and then I'll give you that book up there, the NAFTA agreements. I'm going to give you both. You can take the other one to the library out there.
The standoff continues in Waco this evening.
The KGBS radio personality wants to take a van into the compound with two surgeons to treat any wounded Branch Davidians.
We're treating these people as we treat prisoners of war. Prisoners of war get medical attention. Nobody is receiving medical attention in there.
Charlotte,
you're not answering the question. You're talking around it. Just answer the question. Do you?
No, believe? I don't believe it.
Okay, then you don't believe it.
Why did they kill Randy Weaver's wife? Why did they kill Randy Weaver's 15-year-old son by shooting him in the back four times? Our government has run amok. The FBI, and particularly the ATF, that's the problem. The first article they wrote says in the article they have a 50 caliber machine gun. They've never been able to find a 50 caliber machine gun.
I'm just saying what the ATF did was illegal. Why are they coming into our state the way they're coming in here and just acting like a bunch of renegades?
The entire Branch Davidians were hostages of the ATF. They didn't surrender. They were leaving their homes.
Ron Engelman was outraged over the attack on this peaceful religious commune. The siege was underway and Ron wanted to help.
Monday morning, I decided I'm going to tear him a new ass, the ATF. I go to work Monday morning on my way to work. I'm listening to
his position on the ATF stirred up a lively debate, and Ron Engelman became the target of much criticism from the establishment press.
And we were critical of Ron that we didn't think he should get involved in that part of the process, that he could have caused a set maybe Goresh off in some way or another. We don't know.
Throughout that first Sunday evening, some of the Branch Davidian children were sent out in exchange for the FBI allowing a message from David Koresh to be broadcast over Dallas station KRLD.
My Father, my God who sits on the throne in heaven, has given me a book of seven seals. In Revelation 10, verse 7 of this sealed book, the mystery of God is to be finished.
David Koresh believed, as do all of the Branch Davidians to this day, that they were at the fifth seal. And the fifth seal meant that there was going to be something was going to happen to those that believe in God. At that night, as he was able to broadcast and give messages over the radio, in order for him to do that, he would have to force two or three children to leave their home, to leave their parents, and go into the custody of the same people that had just killed a number of those inside, had wounded a number of those inside, had terrorized everyone inside, and had now had the place surrounded. And these little children were forced to leave their home and go into the hands of those people. I don't know if I would allow my child to do that.
On day three of the siege, Tuesday, March the 2nd, David Koresh sent a tape out with Catherine Madison. The agreement was they would all come out if the tape, a 58-minute sermon, was broadcast on radio stations during prime time.
They were supposed to play the tape at prime time. Now that could have meant two different things. Prime time or drive time on radio would be like from 4 to 6 in the evening. Prime time on television would be like from 7 o'clock till 10 o'clock or 8 o'clock till 11 o'clock. And that's when they wanted the tape played. The tape was actually played at 1:30 in the afternoon, and there's every possibility in the world that they were not listening to the tape or listening to the radio when the tape was played, and therefore never knew that the tape was played. That may be one of the reasons they didn't come out.
The Branch Davidians did not leave Mount Carmel following the broadcast of David Koresh's sermon. The FBI said that David had lied to them. But later, Sheila Martin told us the actual reason for not coming out.
That's one of the reasons Abe stayed in. He knew that the land would become ours. Free and clear, if my understanding is.
Owner of Bout, March the 22nd, 1988, Waco judge issued a verbal order that the Branch Davidians must occupy the 77-acre plot of land continuously for a period of 5 years. Then it would become legally theirs. The five-year period would not expire for another 20 days. Inside Mount Carmel were about 100 people. They represented a diverse racial and cultural mix of nationalities, all there for one purpose only, to study the Bible.
We were trying to live in community like the early apostles did, you know, sharing all things, having things in common. That's why we live together as a family, you know. Like Christ said to the people of his day, who are my brothers and my sisters and my mother? These that are with me, that follow me and do what I say.
Their leader, of course, was David Koresh. Contrary to what the FBI told us, David never claimed to be Jesus Christ. The people inside Mount Carmel followed him because they believed he was a prophet, had great skill in teaching the Bible.
We liked being there. When he had the long studies, it was because we were just having fun. And long studies were just something that was a combination of a lot of things. It wasn't that we sat there all the time. We would have breaks. We'd go off and check on the children and see what things we're going to fix for breakfast. And then we'd come back and, you know, it's normal things that just appear to people. But when you like something, you're going to sit there and you don't mind. And many a time it would be 1 o'clock or 2 o'clock in the morning. You'd say, you know, it's getting late. And we'd say, no, that's all right. And he would take us on such a high level that I couldn't follow him.
I like the scientific, you know, anything scientific. He went into things about space, things about just anything. He hit every subject there was. And I mean, he could give you knowledge about it like you would never learn anywhere else.
Vernon Howell thinks he's the Lamb of God, when all he is a chief thug who interprets the Bible.
Whatever you may think of David Koresh, just remember that your opinion was established by the FBI, which had a tremendous stake in villainizing him.
The persons who follow true religion follow a message, a ministry. Persons who follow a cultic leader follow a man, a messenger, a person. And
mainstream religious leaders such as Dr. Jerry Falwell joined the government's critical view of David Koresh.
My main object was following truth. It was not following a person.
Their religious beliefs, that's their belief. I mean, each person's religion is his own business. I mean, just like each person's politics is. I mean,
those who live near Mount Carmel, such as Walter Dulock, proprietor of a grocery store in Elk, knew the Branch Davidians and had no problem with them.
Yeah, there's one guy, this fellow Woodrow Kendrick, that they got charged with murder. Well, he was in our store a lot of times. He was on a charge account. What did he do? There wasn't nothing wrong with that guy. I mean, you know, I don't know about his personal life, but I mean, to me, he was just an average guy who walks in the store.
It is true that David Koresh had children by some of the other women at Mount Carmel, but our investigation finds the charges of child abuse were false. There were several previous state investigations which also failed to produce any evidence of abuse, and the case was officially closed on April the 30th, 1992.
We had no evidence, so it was a very frustrating time for us.
Talk about this sex business there, I mean, with the underage girls. I don't know whether that's true or fact, or whether that's just, you know, all I know is what I read in the paper and see on TV. And the Child Protective Agencies was out there several times, and they couldn't find nothing wrong. So, I mean, you know, I don't know where all this stuff comes from.
The siege wore on, and all communication with the outside world was cut off. A caller to Ron Engelman's talk show suggested the Branch Davidians move their satellite dish as an indication they were listening.
If they're listening, move the satellite dish. He said, I think it's on Galaxy 6. He said, ask them if they're listening to move the satellite dish to Galaxy 1.
The compound's phone lines have been diverted for a week, keeping David Koresh from the attention he apparently craves. But an FBI ban on contact with the media isn't keeping talk show host Ron Engelman from trying to reach the cult leader. Tuesday morning, he asked compound members over the air to move their satellite dish if they were listening to him.
And about 2 minutes later, Ken comes back on the phone and says, the dish moved. They're listening to you.
Then a caller to Engelman's show suggested a more visible sign.
If they put a weird flag out that second story window or something, it's going to get somebody's attention.
Shortly after noon, a white flag appeared at the second floor window and stayed there for half an hour.
the Branch Davidians and David Koresh do want communications with us. They want me in there. They want the surgeons.
In a later phone call, Branch Davidian member David Thibodeau told how it felt to realize that someone was trying to contact them.
Running up and down the halls going, they're listening, move the satellite dish. You know? It was a very high moment. It was very exciting. I just remember everybody just being so overwhelmed with joy that someone was listening, you know, that someone, that we could communicate somehow to people. They'd cut us off.
The longer they negotiate, the more the people can come out. Koresh, I don't know. He is strongly delusionary, very paranoid, probably sociopathic. He's locked in. I don't know if they'll get him out or not.
Okay, Koresh.
From the very first day, the news media deliberately sought out only those persons with ill feelings towards the Branch Davidians, and David Koresh in particular. All that time, living right here in Waco was a gentleman who was not prejudiced and knew them well.
I am Dewey Millay. I am a naturopathic doctor. I have lived in Waco about 6.5 years. About 5 years ago, I had some Branch Davidians come to me for nutritional health, and they became my patients, as it were. And of course, when the event happened, I said, my goodness, I started putting things together, and here all these people were being attacked, and those people are just like any other human beings. A lot of them had jobs outside of Mount Carmel. A lot of people didn't know that. They, like David Jones, Mary Bell's son, was a mailman. And he had obviously an outside job, and they tithed their money. They either tithed 10 or 20% of their money to the church.
Dr. Dewey Millay believes the media is heavily influenced by government, almost to the point of actual control.
People look at this, have got to look at television and say, now why are they telling me this? Is this a lie? And that will go a long way to educate the American people of knowing how to watch the news. People ask me, why watch Dan Rather? Because I like to see what he's telling the American people. Why is he telling me this? And 9 times out of 10, there's an agenda behind it. They're going to do something to us or for us in some way we're not going to be too happy about. If the American people just get smart and watch the news, they can't trust them at all. We saw what they did here at Mount Carmel. It was just incredible. We watched the press conference every day. And most generally, we have found that they contradict themselves or they told an out-and-out lie.
ATF agents attempted to arrest the head of the cult, a 33-year-old man who claims to be Christ.
He's been described as a beer-drinking guitar player with 15 wives. He claims to be Jesus Christ.
They have homemade explosives, semi-automatic and automatic weapons, hand grenades, grease guns.
One of the latest reports we had was that there was nitroglycerin in ponds.
There would be absolutely no reason in the world to keep nitroglycerin down there. It's ridiculous.
I'd be careful about just filling air when there's really nothing to say, so you start using rumors.
I imagine if they hadn't taken what was given, they'd have had nothing to say.
The FBI had taken control of this scene, and media was told to pack up and move several miles away to the roadblock and out of sight of the Davidian compound. It didn't take long for the lights to start coming down and for the miles of cable to be pulled and packed up. Authorities knew we didn't want to move.
The FBI said news reporters were moved back out of concern for their safety. What about safety for this cameraman during the race riot at the Dallas Cowboys victory parade? Who's concerned for the safety of this news crew in Palestine's West Bank or this recent student uprising in Paris? How about the news crew shooting this little New World Order police action? Aren't they in danger of being shot at? No apparent concern for their safety. The excuse given by the FBI at Mount Carmel as to concern for the reporter's safety was an insult to the intelligence of the American people. The communist Chinese government did the same thing shortly before the massacre at Tiananmen Square.
In one of the interviews with the Chinese people over in Tiananmen Square after it happened, one lady was just sobbing and saying, what could we do? They had all the guns. What could anybody do? There were tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of people out there. And when the government rolled in the tanks, It was all over. They didn't care whether they killed those people or not. They ran all the reporters out so there wouldn't be any witnesses. Same thing that they did down in Waco. In other parts of China, all they knew was what the government was telling them. They had heard that these people in Tiananmen Square were a bunch of bad people, a bunch of revolutionaries, and as far as they knew, the government did the right thing.
We were moved back 2 miles, and I think the media should have protested that, that there should have been some eyes up closer, and I said this from the early beginning, that, okay, maybe they want us back there for our own safety, but you know, when we hired out in this job, most of us hired out and knew that we're going to be facing dangerous situations from time to time, and that's our call. Still,
although Phil Record denies any government media control, the report of the Waco Task Force, published by the Society of Professional Journalists, shows that FBI agent Jeff Jamar reminded radio station KRLD that he represents the government, which licenses broadcast stations.
A license is permission from the government to do something that would otherwise be illegal.
Bob Boaz is a Christian educator and professional media observer.
The federal government's in a position to control the flow of information in this country in a way that has never existed on the face of this earth, and it's done through federal regulatory agencies. The Federal Communication Commission does control what goes out over the airways, both on radio and television. Now, there have been instances of radio stations burning up, of licenses not being renewed, of radio stations and television stations being audited by the IRS to the point they couldn't conduct their business. And anyone in that business, I'm not in it, but I'm not stupid either, and anyone in that business that knows that if they go against government policy, Washington, D.C. policy, they're going to be in trouble.
As the stressors are continually applied to him, he does seem to retreat more and more. We are concerned that he's perhaps going through a mental decompensation and that he is, in fact, becoming more delusional.
1 month after the deadly raid, agents moved closer to the compound, but not to a resolution. Agents say Koresh has prearranged suicide pacts with followers.
The same thing happened at Jonestown in Guyana in 1978.
He has to be slain, and there has to be a sufficient number of martyrs. Those of his followers also have to be slain.
During the siege at Mount Carmel, FBI agents made repeated references to Jonestown, instilling the idea of mass suicide in the minds of the American public.
Anti-cult propaganda never changes. The medium may change, but the kinds of things that are said about...
Author and researcher Mack White notes that Jim Jones and David Koresh were both targets of the same accusations.
They generally tend to be accused of bizarre sexual practices, that the early Christians were accused of that, as well as of incest and other things that the Roman public at that time found abhorrent. In our day, one way to quickly demonize someone in the press in such a way that they'll never be able to recover their public image and their credibility is to accuse them of being a child molester. And that was done in Koresh's case.
White has studied the Jim Jones case for many years. He believes the Jonestown tragedy was not a mass suicide.
The FBI, right after the fire, at its press conference, said that what had happened in Waco was another Jonestown. Now, by saying that, the FBI has invited us to take a closer look at Jonestown.
Jim Jones wanted absolute control over every person in that compound, and he had it. The same thing is going on right now with Koresh in the compound in Waco. You know, I see...
Ross is a deprogrammer for the Cult Awareness Network, which provided ATF officials with all those catchy phrases like child abuse, child sacrifice, illegal weapons, slavery, threats of mass destruction, and the alleged suicide pact. The history of the Cult Awareness Network, however, bears a closer examination. In 1959, Fidel Castro overthrew Batista and seized power in Cuba. Almost immediately, the CIA began plotting his assassination. One suggestion was the use of mind-altering drugs to make Castro go crazy during a speech, thereby losing his credibility with the Cuban people. Operation MK Ultra was initiated with the help of psychiatrists, Drs. Margaret Singer and Lewis West. CIA operative Dr. Margaret Singer was the founder of the American Family Foundation.
Jones had strong ties to the new left of the 70s, to persons like Huey Newton of the Black Panthers and to Dennis Banks of the American Indian Movement. And his church, the People's Temple, was a, by his own description, a Marxist organization.
The leader of this Marxist organization, Jim Jones, had a boyhood friend named Dan Mitrione, who eventually went to work for the CIA, specializing in brainwashing techniques. In 1973, another CIA operator, George Blakey, made the initial $650,000 deposit on the land in Guyana, which became Jonestown. At the same time, Operation MKUltra began directing its attention on religious cults.
There have been many allegations over the years that in some way the CIA's MKUltra program may have been involved in what happened at Jonestown, and that perhaps in this way Jones was manipulated through drugs or hypnosis.
After the tragedy at Jonestown in 1978, Dr. Margaret Singer's American Family Foundation changed its name to the Cult Awareness Network.
So it's ironic that Jonestown, which the FBI used to explain away what happened in Waco, was itself a likely conspiracy.
900 people died in the steamy jungle of Guyana, so 100 more on the plains of central Texas wouldn't matter. When you have no regard for human life, numbers are not important.
To be over at the Brittany Hotel, I was seeing Catherine Madison, Branch Davidian, and after I was through visiting with her, I was downstairs talking to Rita Riddle, and the phone rang, and it was Derek Lovelock saying that he had been released from the county jail, and would somebody come get him. Derek made it pretty clear in his mind that the people that were back there, none of those survived. They were on the east side, away from the camera. And there are some rumors and reports about people seeing things that went on there. We don't know how accurate that is.
Yeah, but we do know that the live footage from April 19th from all the major networks did, in fact, they stated that they saw 25 to 30 survivors, and this was, in fact, confirmed.
What we know is, on the flip side, that there are between 25 and 30 survivors.
We have several witnesses that say that they saw 25 to 30 people exiting out these double doors in this cafeteria. One of the people that survived the fire and is currently under indictment says that he came out that door with Jimmy Riddle that day to escape the fire, and that these people were gunned down in cold blood as they tried to escape.
I believe from what we hear, the rumors we hear, that obviously they didn't go back in the fire of their own choice, and they didn't come out of the fire, so something had to happen to them, and yeah, I think they were murdered.
Nobody wants to admit that their government could possibly be guilty of such a thing, but based on what I found out here over the past 5 months, I have no choice but to say that they were.
You listen to his music for 20 years, I still listen to it. He's been fighting for right to keep and bear arms as long as he's had a handgun since he was a kid. Ted Nugent.
Thank you very much. You noticed. Well, I'm going to just make a simple statement here, because it's so simple, it's stupid.
Even though he disagrees with David Koresh's motives, Rock and roller Ted Nugent has a definite idea about the government's actions.
There are many innocent civilians dead because the ATF abused their powers, got the wrong address, searched with faulty warrants. I know this stuff. It's been documented. Where is this investigation? I'd be willing to let Bill get by with Whitewater for a while till we find out who the murderers are in our government. And that's what's happening. The ATF, even the FBI, the IRS, these people work for us. They are responsible to the American people. They are not being responsible to the American people. And I am deeply saddened. I am hurt. The bottom line is the good people are an asset to America. Leave us alone.
The only real security of liberty in our country is the jealousy and circumspection of the people themselves. Let them be watchful over their rulers. Should they find a combination against them, they have, thank God, the ultimate remedy. That power which created the government can destroy it. Amen. Should the government on trial be found to want amendments, those amendments can be made in a regular method, in a mode prescribed by the Constitution itself. I was taught the same things that most of you were taught. I've learned differently. And we all have that responsibility. And those who died will have died in vain if we leave here today and forget what has happened.
Amen.
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 Mr. Engelman?
Amen.
Amen. I'd like now to read the names of all of those that lost their lives here during that 51 days. Cyrus Howell, David Koresh, Rachel Howell, Star Howell, Sherry Jewell, David Jones, Perry Jones, Michelle Jones, Serenity C. Jones, Bobby Lane Koresh, Steve Schneider, Judy Schneider, Mayana Schneider, Sonia Murray, Douglas Wayne Martin, Wayne Martin Jr., Anita Martin, Sheila Renee Martin, Lisa Martin,
Floyd Hubbard,
Peter Gent,
John McBean,
Peter Hipsman,
Ulrich
Scott Sinobi, Beverly Elliott,
Laura Cita Sinobi,
Susan Benta,
Lisa
Sherry Doyle,
J.D.
Pablo Cohen, Raymond Friesen, Kathy Andrade, Jennifer Andrade, Chanel Andrade, Mike Schroeder, Sandra Hardile. The following names we don't have the last names of: Stone, Sonia, Rebecca, Dabo, and a pair of unnamed twins. BATF agents also lost their lives here, and we're here to memorialize all of those that lost their lives. The following BATF agents: Stephen Willis, Robert J. Williams, Conway LeBeau, Todd McKenna. Now, I think we'd like to spend about a minute just in silent prayer, if you don't mind.
Thank you.
most loving God there is. But you've got to remember one thing. All through the Bible, He's loving and kind. His mercy endures forever. But He's also a warrior. And He is coming back.
Do you think He's going to come back?
Yeah, sooner the better.
Folks, God bless each and every single one of you. You're listening to 101.1 FM Eager, classic radio like you always wished it could be. 101.1 FM is your community service, nonprofit radio station. Stay tuned now for All Oldies Most of the Time.